You got it. So good morning, everyone. Good morning. Very excited to be here with you today and really have the opportunity to share the Word of God with you. It is a real honor to have that the privilege to do that this morning. So before we start with the service, I want to get us again in prayer and lift it up to the Father to help us take the service, because I know God will speak to many of you today. I'm sure that will be the case. Let's lift us up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you, God, for this wonderful morning, Lord, for this beautiful worship service that we just had and music, Lord. We thank you for the worship team. Thank you for bringing us here this morning, Lord. And Lord, please prepare our hearts as we go through the message. Lord, please take anything that may be of me and that is of me, put it aside and may you speak today, Lord. Lord, prepare us as we get to your message. We lift this up in your holy and precious name. Amen. All right. So, many of you remember being told when you were a child that you resemble your mother and father? Any of you remember that? No? I hear someone say no. I told you yes. Okay. I just think we remember that when I was like four or five, and I was not too fond of that. Because I remember just being a child, you know, my naive view. I would look at my father. I usually got compared to my father. People say, hey, Carlos, you look like your dad. And I would look up, saw this big guy. He looked very fat and ugly. He wasn't like that. To my eyes, he was big, you know, but he and kind of old. In reality, he wasn't. He wasn't his prime 30s, good-looking young man. But in my naive view, it was like, I don't want to look like that. But the irony of it is that fast forward the clock, 30 years from now, now my son gets those compliments. I don't know, I'll call it compliments. I don't know if it's compliments. And whenever I hear someone tell us, hey, Giancarlos, you look at your dad. I go like, what? I look at this. I look at this gray hair. I look at this mug. And it's like, ew, now I am the old and fat guy. That's the irony of it. But anyway, my point is that we are influenced by many people in our lives, not only genetically by our fathers, father and mother, but also they're influenced in the way we think, the way we view the world. When we come into this world, we have a mother and father hopefully setting up a good foundation for us on how to view the world, hopefully a good foundation of faith, or lack of, depending on how you grow. As we get older, we get other members from our families kind of having an influence. We kind of start getting different points of view. After that, as we get out of the house, we have our friends kind of influence us in a very profound way, especially when we go to the middle school years and even the teenage years. We have this concept of peer pressure. Maybe you remember that? And those who are, you are young and going through that, you know, we had this outside forces trying to influence us and actually having us behave in a certain manner that we know may not be correct. And as we become adults, we get fully integrated in the world, we have society dictating how we should think. And that's when we develop political views, hopefully we have a foundation of faith, or lack of. We hear of people that drift away from their faith. They might start with a good foundation, that's stage number one, but lead their faith to the state. So we have to be very careful because this influence could be either positive, as I kind of alluded to, if they're based on the Word of God. But if they're not, they can lead us astray. They can lead us astray. And even, and I'll go a little bit far, and even those who, well-intentioned folks and believers, may not always be 100% reliable. Why? Because we're human. We're sinful, and we may not be able to always give the best of advice. So my point is that we should always, always go back to the source. This is trustworthy, reliable advice that you will get, besides from everyone that I can give it to you. So what I want you to do right now is the following. And this may not sound like or be related to what I just mentioned, but just bear with me for a minute. want you to kind of think about the following. Think about at least maybe one or two struggles that you're going through right now. Maybe struggles that you might be going through that you may not be able to shake out. This could be in the area of relationships. Could be in the area of finance, relationship with anyone, your father, mother, co-workers, spouses, you name it. It could be something inside of you in terms of maybe your own sinful desires, maybe an addiction that you're hiding. Think about those right now for a minute. And what I want you to examine right now is, what are you doing to address them? What are the tools, what are the actions that you're taking to address those situations? Are they in line with this? Are they in line with the Word of God? Who is influencing you to address that? Is it the world, is it society, or is it the Word of God? And I'm not bringing this up to just giving you a massive guilt trip, because that's not my point. But I want you to kind of see it, take it out a little bit, and give you tools, or at least one great advice that I found in Scripture that can help us deal with that. And out of all places, this came from the book of 2 Kings and Chronicles. And I found that odd because if you look at the book of Chronicles, if you look at the book of Kings, it talks about the story of the kings of Israel. If you look at this table over here, it talks about, you see how the kingdoms were divided, Judah and Israel, northern and southern. And if you look at the gray shadings, those are the kings who actually did not do good in the eyes of the Lord. They were evil in the eyes of the Lord. You can see there are a lot of those. A lot. If you look at the yellow ones, those are the ones that did right, but were not as good as David. David seems to be the standard of all kings. And then if you look at the green ones, those are the ones that really did good in the eyes of the Lord and followed it all the way through. They did it as good as David. So as I was studying this book, it kind of dawned on me, and got me very interested. What is it that this green shaded kings did differently than others to move away from what society was telling them and really follow the Lord? And today we're going to talk about the story of King Hezekiah and see what he did. And before we go into Hezekiah, we need to understand how he grew up. We need to understand his influences. And if you took a bit of attention to what I just mentioned before, you probably noticed that his father, King Ahaz, was not a good king. He was not a good king. Let's take a look at what he did. The Bible tells us that unlike David, his father, he did not do what was right in the eyes of the Lord, so he did not follow him. He was actually a pagan king. He did not worship the Lord at all. He was king of Judah. He actually was used by Assyria. Actually, the Bible tells us that he bribed the king of Assyria for protection. He was not successful in the things he did. Therefore, he suffered defeat. And it was one interesting defeat that he had by the king of Damascus. And this could take you and let you examine the psyche of this God. He worshipped this pagan idols, and then when he was defeated by the king of Damascus, he realized the following. He said, I'm worshipping these gods, and the king of Damascus is worshipping all these other gods. They seem to be stronger than my gods, so I'm going to follow them. He used a good old saying that if you can't beat them, what do? You join them. That's it. That's how this guy was thinking. Gets you to see his mindset. And to top it off, to really top it off, which to me just takes it to a different level, in his pagan worship, he actually performed child sacrifices. It's something unbelievable in this day and age. The Bible says that he sacrificed one of his sons as part of his pagan rituals. And if I could summarize this in a very theological and deep way, I will tell you that Hezekiah was as follows. He was a messed up king. Again, not a professional or theological, but that's how he ended up. He was not a good king. And this is how Hezekiah grew up. These were his influences. Now let's take a look on the other side and see how Hezekiah did. The Bible tells us that he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father David has done. Again, he's compared to the standard. He worshiped the Lord. He also experienced success. He was able to successfully rebel against Assyria. And there's an interesting story in the Bible when the king of Assyria is besieging, attacking Jerusalem. And he's surrounded, obviously, and then Hezekiah is praying to the Lord. And in this battle, you know how many casualties Hezekiah had in his army? None. That's zero. He has zero because the Lord answered his prayer, and he sent an angel who struck about 185,000 soldiers from the enemy side. He didn't have to do that. He prayed to the Lord, and he was delivered. Therefore, Judah experienced victory. If we keep on going, we read, if we read these accounts, we see that he followed the Lord and he brought revival to the land. He brought up the worship at the temple. He got the people galvanized to follow the Lord. People were excited and were able to now celebrate Passover back in Jerusalem. And people were really, really excited to serve the Lord. They were giving their resources, they were tithing them. It was an exciting time in those days. And he went all the way to destroying the pagan places of worship. He cleaned up the house. And hence, the Lord really honored what he did. And in summary, I could say that he was a man of God. He was a real man of God. But if you take a look at this, this is night and day, isn't it? You had the father. If you look at society around when Hezekiah was growing up, that it was totally different from what he did. So what exactly did Hezekiah do to turn around? And he did something so simple yet profound that if you read the passage, you might just miss it completely. And I'll take you through it right now. It's in the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 29, verses 6 to 10. And it reads as follows: "For our forefathers have been unfaithful and have done evil in the sight of the Lord our God, and have forsaken him and turned their faces away from the dwelling place of the Lord, and have turned their backs." In other words, they did not follow in the Lord at all. They have turned their backs to God. "They have also shut down the doors of the porch and put out the lamps, have not burned incense or offered burnt offerings in the holy place to the God of Israel." In other words, they were not going to church. They were not worshiping at the temple. The passage continues, and it says, "For behold, our fathers have fallen by the sword, and their sons and daughters and their wives are in captivity for this." This is the effect of what Ahaz had in his kingdom. And here it comes. Here it comes. He says, "For now it is in my heart, to make a covenant with the Lord of Israel, that his burning anger may turn away from us." He came from the heart. I'll tell you what he did not do. He did not all of a sudden come up with new laws, new reforms, new political strategies or alignments, or new things to come up and revitalize his kingdom. He did not come up with his own plan. You know why? Because he didn't have to. He didn't have to reinvent the wheel. The plans were already here in Scripture. He only needed to follow the Lord. And that's what happened to us when we address our problems. We try to do things on our own, come up with our own ways of getting around them, where the instruction manual is here. There's plenty of rich advice on how to deal with any situation in life that you can find in this book. And it's a beautiful illustration of what Jesus told us 1,000 years from from Hezekiah. He said, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, all these things will be given unto you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. It is a beautiful illustration. He did not come up with his own plans, did not start with his own thinking. He said, I need to follow the Lord first. He did this. He stopped. He looked back, looked up, and listened. Again, he stopped, looked back, looked up, and listened. In other words, he stopped, was still, and paused, and realized what was happening, and asked the Lord to intervene. And the looking back is where you see the passage before. He took assessment of the situation, and realized that if he kept on going with the same plans his father had, things were not going to change. As a matter of fact, it would have gone, probably gotten worse. But he realized that the course of action that the kingdom was taking was not correct. So he took an assessment of the situation. And that's the same thing we should do in life. Take a moment when you're going through tough times and you see that things are not working out. You may not even feel that the Lord is there. You might need to do this. You might need to stop, be still, look back, take an assessment of the situation, and see, are my actions reflective of the Lord's choices? After that, he listened. This is the same thing we should do. Listen, you pray, and he looked at the instruction manual. Oh, he said, your foundation, your hope should all be based on the teachings of the Lord. And I could not think of a better example of someone that has gone through tough times than the Hoffmans. Deb and Bill have gone through many rough times. But through it, I have seen them that they have held on tight to the Lord. They have never given their hope because they know that no matter what happens to them, they have to trust in Him. They know that God has a plan for them. And it's a beautiful example for us to follow as we go through the many things in life. I'm going to show you an example of what not to do. And this actually came a little bit personal, though. It reminds me of what happened to us in the DR when we went back to, or we went to the mission trip this past January. And then for those of you who don't know, we go every year to the Dominican Republic. And we do missions work there for about a week. We do many things, children's ministry, optical, we help translate and so forth. In this particular year, we faced a difficult challenge in coming back. We were supposed to come back on a Saturday, but a big storm, for those of you who remember, hit the eastern area of the United States. Hundreds of flights were getting canceled. And at the beginning of the week, we had to make some difficult decisions. We actually decided to fly a good portion of the group back to New Jersey. Actually, we tried to get everyone out on that Thursday. We got almost all of them, about, maybe say 90%. But six of us had to stay behind because we just couldn't find a room in any flight. And I distinctly remember Victor and I, we were in a roll, we were in a battle. We said we are going to come back to New Jersey no matter what. And we were spending countless hours looking online. We were talking to the United representatives. We booked out like three or four times. We had reservations. And every time we make a reservation, we were like, yeah, we did it. And then hours from then, we got a notification from United saying, sorry, your flight got canceled. This started Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And it was just going on and on. And all of a sudden on Sunday, somebody had the bright idea of pray. Duh! We should have thought of that before, right? You know, those are the times when I wish we had probably an elder, maybe a pastor, a treasurer, possibly all three were there, never mind. Just edit that out. You know. It was a Peter moment, we're not playing. But, you know, in all seriousness, we decided to pray. So we got together as a group, We ended up praying with Jim McDonald. Jim McDonald's the founder of Meeting God in Missions. Great man, great testimony I have. The Lord has used him. So we're all praying as a team, we're all praying as a group. The amazing thing is that as we were praying, as we were seeing all the bad news, cancellations, and so forth, we felt this peace. You remember that, Victor, right? We felt this peace. And God telling us, I have a plan for you. I am in control. Although things around you may seem chaotic, I am in control. So after we were done praying, like I said, we felt that peace and the trust because we surrendered our will to him. And we started following his plan. As a matter of fact, after we were done praying, Jim told us, you know, we were going through the session, this particular passage came to mind. Same passage I mentioned to you. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you. He told us, you guys should have been on your knees the very first moment. And he was right. He was right. Again, this is what we need to do when we are faced with problems. We need to go prepare. We need to go with our full armor in battle. Fill the shield of faith and belt of truth and breastplate of righteousness and all the items that we have in the armor of God. You know what happened? We sometimes don't do that. And instead of going with the armor, we go butt naked into battle. And we expect victory. We had to go prepare. And it was not until we stopped, we looked back, listened, and started to pray that we felt the presence of the Lord. And to top it off, I remember after we were done praying, we were chit-chatting with Jim McDonald there, and Victor, I left the room at that point. And he came back a few minutes back. And he said, guys, we're flying tomorrow. We said, what? Yeah, we're flying tomorrow. You see, the plane that we were expecting to leave Chicago to Punta Cana left as we were praying. It was in the air as we were praying. Folks, you can't make this stuff up. It was not until we surrendered our will that the Lord really showed us his power. He didn't have to do it. But it was amazing. He showed us that he had a plan. And I wish that there were more stories of what happened afterwards than that. Unfortunately, don't have the time. But he indeed had a purpose for us. And, it was quite amazing. What I'm going to remind you to do is the following. Remember what Hezekiah did in his method. He stopped, he looked back, and listened. And the middle part, let me go back a little bit, the middle part is usually the hard one, looking back. The reason it's hard is because when we look back, we have to examine ourselves and realize if we are really following the Lord's will. If our actions reflect the Word of God. And the problem with that is we as individuals have this tendency to deflect blame, right? Oh, it's not my fault, it's someone else's fault. Oh, I mean, justify my actions because I'm unrighteous and so forth. And I don't want you to, when you do this, look at the situation, but I want you to look at yourself. Forget about whether it's your fault or someone else's fault. Are your actions reflecting the Word of God? That's tough. And if you're not sure how to do this, I'm going to give you a quick, what I call health check. And these are three very simple verses. And there are many in Scripture. But I'm going to give you three that you can try to go back to and see if your actions are in line. Think about this. Is God first? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Is God in the middle of that situation? Or are you and your own desires trumping them? Think about that. Second one. Did you forgive? This is a tough one. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Again, I don't really care if it's your fault or not in a situation. Have you forgiven even those individuals who have done bad against you? The Bible tells us that we should forgive. The Bible goes as far as saying we should pray for our enemies. And the last one. Are you second? Oh, this is a tough one. I can tell you that from my own personal experience. Are you second? Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. It's Philippians 2, 3, 5. Are you second? I got a very great marital advice from, actually, Jim McDonald. He told us, when you are in a heated discussion with your wife or your husband, and whenever it's said and done, I want you to do the following. I want you to go back and say to him or her that you're sorry. And I don't care whether it's your fault or her fault. I want you to go back and say, I'm sorry. Because remember, it takes two to fight. Are you second? I'm convinced that if we follow the verses and instructions like that, our marriages will be an example to others. And this is what God wants us to do. And this may be a little bit overwhelming for many of you because now you're saying, well, you know, I have to now, you know, turn around and do something. And the beauty of it is that if you do like Hezekiah did, and he asks for help, he will meet with you. And you can take many of his promises to the bank, like the one you see on the screen right now. He says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Folks, he's there to help you. Same way he helped Hezekiah, same way he helped us come back from Jersey in ways that we were not expecting. God, the same ways you tap into. He is there to help you if you ask him for his guidance. So, remember this week, you're going through a tough time, to either stop, look back, and listen. Very, very simple way that Hezekiah did to turn around. And it's never too late. You might be saying, oh, Carlos, you know, you don't know what I'm going through. The situation here is hopeless. No. Take that promise to the bank. It's never too late to turn around and do whatever damage has been done. Trust in him. Trust in him. So in that way, I'm going to close us in prayer with the following. As we pray and we close our service, I want you to kind of reflect on those things that I mentioned before, maybe those struggles that you're going through right now. And we're going to ask the Lord to really help us out today. And again, trust in his promises that he can deliver us. You know, the same way he has delivered us from many things. I mean, again, I'm taking you back to the example of the top one. He has taken us to tough times. So let's lift us up in prayer. Dear Father, Lord, we just want to thank you, Father, for really challenging us this morning. For really telling us to trust in that you have for us. To look back and take assessment of what you may be doing and see if it's in line with you, Father. Lord, open up our hearts to see what you want to store for us. Lord, help us determine what course we need to take, Lord. If we need to make a correction in the course, Lord, help us to do that and follow you, Lord. And Lord, for those of you who have been faithful, Lord, may you continue to bless them, Lord. More importantly, Lord, may they be able to share their beautiful testimony with others, Lord. Testimony of how you have provided for them, Lord. So, Lord, we lift up to you all these needs, and we trust and we know that you will carry us through and we seek you with all our hearts. We pray this in your holy and precious name. Amen. So in order to close, as you notice, we don't have the worship team again in the afternoon off. So we're going to have our final song through a slideshow. And as we sing the song, lyrics are there. Keep a close eye on those lyrics because beautiful songs from Matt Mayhem. And it will tell you how much and how often you need God. If I could get the lights. Just stand up.
Lord, I come, I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you.
Trust. And Lord, remember that we need him. Every hour of the day we need him. And remember to stop, look back, and listen if you have. May the Lord bless you, and you have a great afternoon. Amen.